Good evening. My name is David Oxtoby. I'm the president of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, and it's my pleasure to welcome you and call to order the 2087th stated meeting of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. Tonight's program is on arms trafficking, its past, present, and future. It's a Morton Mandel public lecture made possible through the generosity of the Jack, Joseph, and Morton Mandel Foundation, named for our dear friend and Academy member, Mort Mandel, who just passed away last month at the age of 98. Mort's generosity enabled the Academy to further the impact of our studies, provide greater outreach to members across the country and around the world, and address issues with our technology and infrastructure. So tonight we remember Mort with profound gratitude and warm memories. It's truly a pleasure for me to return to the Berkeley campus, where I spent some very rewarding years as a graduate student in the College of Chemistry, right next door, I'm not sure which direction right now, that side, okay, right next door to this faculty club. And so I have a personal relationship with Berkeley, but also Berkeley is a very good friend of the Academy, many members of the Academy from Berkeley, and Berkeley is also an important member of the affiliates program at the American Academy. The mission of the Academy is to honor excellence and convene leaders from every field of human endeavor to examine new ideas and address issues of importance in the nation and the world. Academy members are leaders in the arts and sciences, business, philanthropy, and public affairs. In 2019, 10 new members were elected from this campus, from Berkeley. Some recent topics addressed through our projects and studies include the future of undergraduate education, the public face of science, the new nuclear age, and the practice of democratic citizenship and the arts. The Academy has even addressed the topic of discussion for tonight, arms trafficking. In 1994, so that's 25 years ago, the Academy's Committee on International Security Studies hosted the first major international workshop on the dangers posed by the increased proliferation of small arms and light weapons in conflict areas around the world. Academic analysts, government officials, representatives from human rights organizations and other NGOs, and other experts convened to discuss new ideas for monitoring and controlling trade in these weapons. A second workshop examined the many policy initiatives being undertaken by national governments, regional and international organizations and NGOs to control the deadly traffic in small arms and light weapons. The project produced two books, one called Lethal Commerce, the Global Trade in Small Arms and Light Weapons, and the second one, Light Weapons and Civil Conflict, the first authored by Jeffrey Boutwell, Michael Clare, and Laura Reed, and the second by Boutwell and Clare. The authors called for a new international regime to regulate trade in light and medium weapons. More recently, an Academy project on new dilemmas in ethics, technology, and war, led by Professor Scott Sagan of Stanford University, brought together an interdisciplinary group of scholars and practitioners to investigate ethical dimensions proposed by contemporary political developments and changes in military technology. In addition to projects and studies, the Academy also examines timely issues through a nationwide series of events. A network of local program committees in 15 locations around the country works to initiate and organize many of our programs. We're grateful to the Academy's Berkeley Program Committee, and especially member David Hollinger, for organizing tonight's event. It's now my pleasure to introduce David, who will moderate tonight's discussion. He is the Preston Hotchkiss Professor of American History Emeritus here at Berkeley, was elected to the American Academy in 1997. A scholar of American intellectual and ethno-racial history, his books and articles include studies of pragmatism, modernism, multiculturalism, nationalism, and cosmopolitanism. Please join me in welcoming David Hollinger.
Well, on behalf of the Academy's Berkeley Committee, Randy Sheckman, who's here tonight, and Pam Samuelson, who is unable to be here, and myself, I'm glad to introduce you this evening, introduce the speakers. And the way I'm going to proceed is that first I'll introduce our main speaker, Brian DeLay, and then when he's finished his talk, I'll introduce the three follow-up speakers. I want to say as a preliminary, though, that that we selected tonight as a date partly because We were aware that some of you wanted a substantial intellectual excuse not to watch the debates. And so that's something else that you owe to the Berkeley Committee of the Academy. Now, on arms trafficking, we all know that this is important. And I was told the other day that right now, there's an average of $60 billion a year. That's 60 billion, not million, is the dollar amount of what the world gun running trade is. Now, it may be that some of our speakers will have more up-to-date information about that. My source is Wikipedia, and they know a lot more about this than I do. Our first speaker, Brian DeLay, is one of the great prides of the history department. He is best known for his book, The War of a Thousand Deserts, which is about the Comanches and the Texas Anglos and the Mexicans in the 1830s and 1840s. This book was so important that it won 6 book prizes and is remembered as a classic already in the increasingly important field of borderlands history, as well as a book that helped to reestablish military history as a substantial part of the American historical profession, as well as a signal contribution to the larger field of US and the world. My colleague, Brian DeLay.
Well, thank you, David, for that introduction. And I wanna thank the Academy for inviting me to speak tonight. It's a great honor to speak with you. And I'm going to begin with something that I think will surprise absolutely none of you and tell you that the United States is the arsenal to the world. And I had initially planned on speaking about the kind of big picture of US arms trading over the long term. And I wanted to root that discussion in a broader conversation about the connection between the US government and the private arms industry, which has been present and essential to the American arms industry since the revolution. Part of the reason I thought that would be interesting is that the gun lobby has invested enormous resources in convincing the public that the government is the enemy of the arms business instead of its historic and indispensable patron. But as I began trying to plan this talk, I kept seeing really disturbing news coming out of Mexico that also was very relevant to the theme of tonight's event. So as I'm sure all of you know, a month ago, a military unit from the Sinaloa cartel used 50 caliber M2 machine guns and other military grade weapons to free the son of the jailed Mexican kingpin Joaquin El Chapo Guzman from state custody, a profoundly humiliating and disturbing event for the Mexican government. The weapons they used almost certainly came from the United States. 2 weeks ago, cartel hitmen murdered 3 women and 6 children from a single Mormon family. Again, I know that you all know this. And these cartel hitmen left behind hundreds of shell casings made from the US arms manufacturer Remington. Asked about the role of US arms trafficking in these awful events, an official with the ATF said, "This is an ongoing problem. It's been with us for a while." Now, as a 19th century historian, I can attest to that fact. With the possible exception of Haiti, Mexico has had a longer and more destabilizing relationship with American guns than any country in the world. There's an old saying in Mexico, "Poor Mexico, so far from God, so close to the United States." The country's 2,000-mile-long land border with the hemisphere's preeminent arms manufacturer and exporter hardwired instability into Mexico's first century after its independence. Over the next 3.5 hours, I hope to convince you of this. Oh, just kidding. After the next 20 minutes or so, I hope to convince you of this by taking you on a very quick tour through Mexico's 19th century history, explaining how U.S. arms trafficking intervened at critical moments in that history to destabilize Mexican governance. Before I get to that history, I want to say something quickly about
how buyers in this story acquired the weapons that they used to pursue their own political projects. They paid outright. That was one method, to pay outright either with gold and silver, bills, cotton, horses, sometimes slaves. Others, particularly governing elites and well-connected purchasers looking to buy in bulk, they paid with bonds, with loans, or with vaguer kinds of promises about what they would do once they took power. The political scientist Michael Ross, who's a specialist in conflict in post-Cold War Africa, refers to the market for such promises as booty futures. He notes that this is a particularly destabilizing kind of finance, precisely because it empowers the weak and the usually disconnected to do things that they otherwise would not have the power to do and probably wouldn't even try if they didn't have that support. Booty futures figure prominently into the story that I'm going to share with you tonight. Finally, a warning. Mexico's misfortunes in the 19th century were so profound and so numerous as to almost defy belief. But I promise I'm not making this up. In fact, I'm actually leaving out a lot of cataclysmic things that happened in 19th century Mexico. So I'm going to begin with Mexico's War for Independence. This was a longer, bloodier, far more destructive war than the American Revolution. It lasted from 1810 to 1821. And among many other places in what had been New Spain and what was going to become the independent Republic of Mexico, it had devastating consequences for the underpopulated province of Texas. That was so because Mexican insurgents struggled to ever capture a seaport and therefore understood that their best chance of arming the insurgency was to acquire a border with the United States. And so there was fierce fighting over the land border between Texas and Louisiana. Crown officials, not wanting to see this happen, also invested significant resources in stopping that project. And so Texas is really torn to pieces during these 10 years. Its already small population is cut almost in half, and its animal wealth, which was really the main economic enterprise in Texas at the time, all but collapsed. Now, the reason that this is an important story to share, first of all, is just as a measure of the antiquity of the US arms trafficking problem in the US relationship, US-Mexico relationship, but more importantly because the devastation in Texas from 1810 to 1821 prompts the newly independent republic, once Mexico achieves independence in 1821, to make a very important decision. They decide that in order to hold on to this territory, they're going to have to populate it, and that the most efficient way to populate it would be to invite Anglo-American settlers in from the United States into Texas to become good Mexicans and to populate this faraway province. Now, at the same time that the government made that fateful decision, it was trying to figure out how to arm and defend itself as an independent post-colonial state. Mass producing arms domestically was too complex and expensive. This is something that Priya can explain much better than I can. And that was not going to be an option, certainly not in the short term. And in Mexico's case, it wouldn't even be an option by the early 20th century, just too difficult. Partly because the technological horizon just races forward in the 19th century far too quickly for Mexico to ever catch up. Moreover, broke and exhausted from its long war for independence, Mexico lacked the cash necessary to buy brand new arms on the open market from one of the major global producers at the time. So in the mid-1820s, Mexico secures two major loans from prominent banks in London, guaranteed by two-thirds of all the country's customs receipts, which were really its only reliable source of income at that moment. Much of this loan is immediately converted into used war material. All this stuff is left over from the Napoleonic Wars. 4 frigates, 5,000 pairs of pistols, 4,000 carbines, and 70,000 East India pattern Brown Bess muskets. Now, this was supposed to be the beginning of a prolonged arming campaign that would gradually build up state capacity over the coming decades. But the Mexican government was not going to secure another arms deal this large for the rest of the entire century, because just 3 years after making this deal with these London banks, Mexico defaults on its payments. Mexico would in fact spend the next 60 years in sovereign default, more or less barred from international capital markets, and consequently, terrifically unstable. Because it was barred from international capital markets and because it didn't have adequate revenue, Mexico is unable to finance even basic tasks of central government, and therefore it is consequently terrifically unstable over the course of most of the 19th century. I'll give you just one metric. In the 35 years between 1821 and 1856, Mexico had 53 separate governments operating under 4 different constitutional systems. So just an absolute churn of political turmoil. Now, for a generation, that meant that Mexico's leaders would have to face crisis after crisis with an already used, outmoded, dwindling arsenal that was more or less fixed. The adequacy of that arsenal was tested in the mid-1830s in Texas. So here we get back to those Texans I was talking about a moment ago. Over the previous 15 years, those Anglo-American colonists that Mexico had invited into Texas, along with many, many African slaves, had arrived in greater numbers than Mexico anticipated and far greater numbers than Mexico even wanted. Indeed, in 1830, Mexico criminalizes, panicking, Mexico criminalizes further immigration from the United States into Mexico. Unsurprisingly, American immigrants totally ignore this prohibition. And so all these American, Anglo-American illegals continue to pour into Mexico, bringing enslaved men, women, and children with them, also in contravention of Mexican law. In 1835, these colonists rebel against the central government. Now, rebellions had happened in Mexico before. Other larger, more powerful states had rebelled against the central government. And in each case, the central government had handily put down the rebellion. So why did the Texans think that they could do better? They were confident, but that doesn't really explain it. They didn't have anything like the number of men, the weapons, or the money that the Zacatecans had. Zacatecas had a rebellion. Zacatecas was completely crushed by the central government. So why did Texas do this? Well, Texas had two advantages that Zacatecas did not. It shared a land border with the United States, and it had an increasingly precious booty future, cotton land. So Texan authorities began hatching desperate land for arms deals. The most consequential were deals cut in New Orleans by Texas agents who had been authorized to exchange up to 1.25 million acres of prime cotton land in exchange for war material. These Texans relied on all these arms and all this ammunition that comes from Louisiana, along with some men that come from Louisiana as well, to defeat the Mexican army in 1836. After the rebellion, they got a close look at those Brown Bess muskets that Mexico had nearly bankrupted itself for several years before, because they capture 800 of them after the final battle in their war for independence. And you can see here that the Mexican emblem has been stamped onto the lock of this Napoleonic War era Brown Bess musket. Now, while all this is unfolding, this catastrophe is unfolding, arms trafficking was helping to produce yet another catastrophe in northern Mexico in this exact same time. Mexico had title to a sprawling northern territory, what's now the American West at the time. But most of that territory was practically controlled by indigenous polities. For complex reasons, the uneasy peace that Mexico had enjoyed with Comanches, Apaches, Kiowas, Navajos, other native peoples, this peace collapses in the 1830s. Armed with guns and ammunition obtained from other native people who themselves had gotten them from American agents or American merchants, mounted indigenous warriors began launching raiding campaigns across the whole of northern Mexico. Over the next decade, these campaigns claimed thousands of Mexican and native lives, depopulated vast swaths of northern Mexico, and wrecked the ranching economy that was the mainstay for the entire north of the country. Raiders paid for their guns with stolen mules, stolen horses, and also with Mexican captives. And they were able to traverse all or parts of 9 Mexican states because almost always they were far better armed than the Mexicans that they encountered. Now, Mexico's harried government by the late 1830s, early 1840s is promising, we are going to conquer los indios barbaros, these native people, and we are going to reconquer Texas. These were empty promises. Its army was limping into the mid-1840s with a dwindling number of outmoded guns, only about 33,000, according to the Minister of War, and they had some 635 cannon of various calibers, most of which dated from the colonial period. That this arsenal was unequal to the national task became agonizingly clear in 1846 when the United States invaded Mexico and provoked the U.S.-Mexican War. After every successful battle, the far better armed U.S. forces seized the weapons that they had captured from their defeated Mexican adversaries and almost always chose to destroy them. After his victory at the Battle of Cerro Gordo, for example, General Winfield Scott determined that the 4,000 muskets he'd seized from the conquered Mexican army that day were all far too substandard for his men to use, so he had them all destroyed. Now, some in Mexico wanted to continue fighting the United States even after Mexico City itself was occupied by U.S. troops, but it's not at all clear how the state could have possibly waged that war. In the spring of 1848, Mexico's shocked Minister of War reported that government stores contained 48 functioning cannon and a mere 121 muskets for the whole country, as far as the national government was concerned. The U.S. insisted that Mexico surrender more than half of its national territory as a precondition for ending the war. So this is the great cataclysm of 19th century Mexican history. At the conclusion of the U.S.-Mexican War in 1848, then, Mexico was not only less than half the size it had been when it achieved independence, but it was internally fractious, it was groaning under vast internal and international debts, and it was as gun poor as it had ever been in its post-colonial history. But this state of affairs was not going to last very long. After several years of exhausted peace, Mexico plunged into a destructive civil war between liberals and conservatives known as the War of Reform. And, you know, importantly, this ongoing political turmoil is being produced in large measure by profound disagreements about what is to be done about the national crisis. And in this case, it erupted into civil war. So Mexico first is plunged into a devastating civil war, and then when that civil war ends in early 1861, it's only months before Mexico is once again invaded by a powerful foreign enemy. Seizing on the perennial matter of Mexico's unpaid debts and upon U.S. distraction in its own civil war, France invaded Mexico in 1861 and soon installed a European prince as Emperor Maximilian I. Mexico's liberal government, led by Benito Juarez, steadily lost ground and actually in 1865 had to flee the country entirely north into Texas. Now, the one good thing about being driven out of your country and being forced into Texas is that you're in close proximity to a lot of guns. Juarez follows a pattern that by then had become well established. He sent dozens of agents out to dozens of American cities, and he held them sell millions of dollars worth of Mexican government bonds at desperately discounted prices. These agents found very prominent buyers. The list of Mexico's erstwhile patrons in 1865, 1866 reads like a list of the who's who of America's incipient Gilded Age. It included J.P. Morgan, William Aspinwall, Anson Phelps, Moses Taylor, and the country's most powerful arms dealer, the man you see behind me, Marcellus Hartley. These investors provided the money and the material necessary to equip the liberal reconquest of Mexico. The bill for all the material that these patrons handed out started coming due in 1867, as soon as Juarez and his forces took Mexico City, captured Maximilian, and famously executed him. The bondholders in New York City primarily, but also in other places in the United States, hatched a multitude of business schemes in Mexico, in the following months. And I think this was, in fact, the purpose of scooping up all of these discounted Mexican bonds to begin with. Mexico had absolutely earned its reputation for financial insolvency. And so the idea that these savvy, extremely powerful capitalists would buy these bonds expecting prompt repayment was absurd. I think that they bought these bonds not because they expected prompt repayment, but because they knew that it would give them leverage. Leverage over things that they regarded as far more important and promising in Mexico. These were things like land deals, mining concessions, commercial privileges, and above all, by the mid-1860s and early 1870s, railroad contracts, which is where the real money was. Juarez did a fair job trying to hold these creditors at bay and explaining, well, we're not sure all these bonds are legitimate, and we are, of course, going to have to put our house in order, but you know, on and on and on. And he manages to hold them off for quite a while until he finally dies in 1872. Thereafter, pressure mounts on his ally and his successor, a man named Sebastian Lerdo. Now, Lerdo, like Juarez, was a proud nationalist. He did not have the means to pay back all these bonds, not at the, in the time scale that the creditors demanded. And he certainly had no intention of handing the US creditors the economic keys of the kingdom. In 1875, after beating his rival Porfirio Diaz in that year's presidential election, Lerdo even canceled all of the outstanding US railroad contracts that had been issued. He decided that these were not in the national interest. And he rejected a bilateral trade agreement that had been seen by these creditors as their last best hope of ever getting their money back. So, in 1876, these bondholders conspired with their stymied colleagues in the railroad business to help Diaz depose Lerdo in a coup. Bondholders sent Diaz $320,000 in cash through an intermediary, and arms and ammunition soon began arriving in bulk right at the Mexican, at the Texas border, which is where Diaz was waiting for them. Thus equipped, Diaz deposed Lerdo and soon won election to the presidency. And then relying on these foreign partners and others that he cultivated very skillfully and on massive amounts of foreign investments, Diaz would go on to build an effective and extremely well-armed dictatorship that would have control of the country for about 33 years. Now, there is a crooked but unbroken line between Mexico's frantic scramble for arms in the 1850s and the 1860s on one hand, and the rise of the Diaz dictatorship on the other hand. Coups were nothing new in Mexico, certainly by this time. But the direct and the decisive influence of American capital in toppling an elected government abroad, that was pretty new in the 1860s and the 1870s. As Juarez and Lerdo understood, all that was required were the investments that gave American businessmen the sense of entitlement necessary to intervene in foreign governance. In Mexico's case, those investments had their modest but absolutely indispensable beginnings with the arms trade. Now, once in power, Diaz transforms Mexico over the coming decades. His rule was marked by rapid development, savage inequality, and foreign ownership of broad swaths of the economy. And he cooperated with the United States to do something that governments, Mexican governments in particular, had failed to do for decades, and that is conquer the Comanches, the Apaches, the Yaquis, and other powerful native peoples that had controlled so much of the part, this part of the continent for so long. These conquests paved the way for unprecedented economic investment in the borderlands, and then when Diaz finally himself falls from power, beginning with a revolution, the Mexican Revolution in 1910, it was too a revolution equipped with arms from the United States. Diaz's very successes, in fact, helped lay the groundwork for his eventual overthrow. Merchants in Texas, New Mexico, Arizona, and California, with native peoples out of the way, now had the capital, the connections, and the transportation infrastructure necessary to channel war material from its production sites in eastern North America and Connecticut, upstate New York, to borderland buyers in virtually unlimited quantities. This is something that would have been very difficult before. Moreover, the proliferation of huge mining, ranching, and agricultural enterprises south of the border, almost all of them American-owned, gave revolutionaries like Pancho Villa abundant targets from whom to extort or plunder cash, crops, cattle, things that could be traded for war material just north of the border. Even today, the most recognizable icon of the Mexican Revolution is a fighting man or a fighting woman dressed in American-made ammunition. For the next decade, American arms and ammunition pours into Mexico in absolutely unprecedented quantities. And for enterprising merchants in the Southwest, it was the great bonanza of their lifetimes. They supplied all comers with war material of every description. One of the most notorious examples of this non-discriminatory ethic comes from the huge El Paso arms and hardware firm Krakauer, Zork, and Moy, which once sold the Federales 1,000 kilometers of barbed wire and then immediately turned around and offered their rivals, the Constitutionalists, all the wire cutters that they had in stock. Arms trafficking came to attract citizens of prominence as well. In 1911, Laredo's former mayor, Amador Sanchez, got caught using the county jail as a depot for weapons destined to be smuggled into revolutionary Mexico. Now, why did Sanchez have access to the jail? Well, that's because in addition to being the president of the Webb County School Board, he was also the county sheriff. And he later received a presidential pardon for his violation of US neutrality laws. And he kept both of his jobs. So the Mexican Revolution is this incredible business opportunity for arms dealers across the borderlands. And when it finally grinds to a halt around 1920, 1921, it had left absolute wreckage in its wake. There were more than a million people died because of war-related casualties in that decade, absolute catastrophe. Gun violence, of course, never goes away. Even in Mexico, when the war ends, it's still a stubborn problem. But US arms trafficking by 1910 had ceased to pose a first order problem for the state for almost a century. But as you all know, we are again living in a time where US arms trafficking is posing a first order problem to the Mexican state. So I'm going to close tonight with just a few words about how this 19th century wraith has returned to afflict Mexico today in the 21st century. The origin of the current horrible violence that is afflicting so much of Mexico really gets going in 2006. Following a disputed election, Mexico's newly installed president, Felipe Calderón, declared war on his country's drug cartels and deploys the army against them in several sites around the country. And the pressure that the Mexican state now was bringing to bear upon the cartels sparked an intense and vicious competition between cartels for territory and for transportation routes into the United States. Gun violence soared across much of the country, despite the fact that it is legally very difficult to purchase firearms in Mexico. In the whole country, there is a single store where civilians may purchase firearms, and the army decides who can and cannot shop there. Nonetheless, guns are not at all difficult to acquire in Mexico. The large majority of them are smuggled in from the United States. By 2012, there were some 6,700 licensed US arms dealers in the border region. That's more than three arms dealers, licensed arms dealers, for every mile of the US-Mexican border. A recent study suggests that straw buyers, that is to say people who go in ostensibly buying for themselves but are in fact going in to buy for others, shopping at these borderlands arms stores and elsewhere in the country, purchased about 250,000 guns in 2012 alone to smuggle into Mexico. And the media doesn't pay nearly enough attention to this phenomenon, but when it does, it usually concentrates on guns. Ammunition is at least as important, and it's far less regulated in this country than guns are. And because ammunition is not a permanent commodity like these guns are, it is all the more critical that it be attained in bulk, and that's easy enough to do in the United States. So by the end of Calderon's term in 2012, his drug war had gone spectacularly wrong. And he wanted others with whom he could share the blame, understandably, and he identified plausible villains in the U.S. arms industry and in the U.S. state that had not done nearly enough to regulate the arms trade. Calderon went to Ciudad Juarez, which had become probably the most dangerous place on Earth by 2012. And he had 3 tons of confiscated American guns melted into this massive sign that you see behind me here. He erects this sign near a bridge connecting El Paso to Ciudad Juarez, and it was a stark protest against the so-called Iron River of guns flowing from the United States into Mexico. Now, Juarez's mayor never liked this sign. I think he thought it was bad for tourism. But maybe he thought that the message had been received. So after leaving it up there for just a little while, he has it removed and taken away, but he takes the period underneath the exclamation point and he gives it to the US Embassy in Juarez, just as a subtle little memento. But the problem, of course, only deepened in the years since that sign went down. In 2018, Mexico's homicide rate set an all-time record, surpassing the previous high, which was in 2017. 2019 is on pace to surpass 2019 is on pace to surpass 2018. Gun violence accounts for about 70% of all of the homicides in Mexico today. And the country's national security minister recently complained that on average 2,000 guns go illegally across the border into Mexico to fuel this violence. And if that's true, that would be about 3 times as many guns than what I cited in the study just a few moments ago in the paper. So I think Calderon's sign needs to go back up. And I think that versions of it need to go up on every crossing point across, all along the border, all 2,000 miles of it. Too few Americans realize how consequential our gun laws are for Mexico and for Mexicans. When we allowed our national assault weapons ban to expire in 2004, gun violence went up in northern Mexico. Lax regulation of ammunition purchases in many states, in particular Arizona, make it nearly friction-free for cartels to buy and smuggle in what they need in bulk. The gun lobby and their Republican allies in Congress have hobbled the ATF in wide varieties of ways that have significant implications for Mexico. And the so-called gun show loophole that permits gun sales without background checks in this country is perfect to facilitate straw purchases that fuel cartel violence. So in other words, and to conclude, cartel's plaintive sign captures a basic fact that is as true today as it was in the 19th century. The people with the most leverage over the problem of arms smuggling into Mexico read English. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Brian. We'll now hear three additional speakers, and I'll introduce them all now, and then they will come up and talk in that order, and then they will join Brian here at the table, and we'll take questions from the audience. Our first additional speaker will be Priya Satia of the Stanford History Department. Priya is also from known to us here as a Berkeley PhD, and she first became famous for a book of hers of about 10 years ago, Spies in Arabia, the Great War and the Cultural Foundation of Britain's Covert Empire and the Middle East. And she's more recently been working directly in this gun-running, arms trafficking domain. And her most recent book is called Empire of Guns, The Violent Making of the Industrial Revolution. Now, after Priya has spoken, we'll then hear from Ron Hassner of Berkeley's Political Science Department. And Ron is known as an expert on religion and warfare and has worked particularly on that relationship in the modern Middle East. Ron is one of the brave people who write about contemporary Middle Eastern politics and with reference to Israel. And indeed, just the other evening, Ron was inaugurated here as the first occupant of the campus's Helen Diller Family Professorship in Israel Studies. Ron did his doctorate at Columbia, but did his BA and MA at Stanford. When we've heard from Ron, then Daniel Sargent will be our final speaker of the evening. Daniel, a member of our history department here, a very prominent figure in the field of American diplomatic history and world international history, best known for a book of his, A Superpower Transformed, the Remaking of American Foreign Relations in the 1970s. So I'll ask Priya to come up and get us started, and then we'll have this relay of three. Priya.
Thank you. Can you all hear me? Okay. Ron just mentioned to me, reminded me, this might be my only chance to utter the sentence, I want to thank the Academy. I stole your joke. I'm so sorry. I couldn't resist. Right? So yes, thank you so much for having me here. And let's get started. And thank you, Brian, for your great talk and very timely. So the word trafficking can mean simply trade. But it typically implies an illegal trade. And I'm going to speak broadly about the past and present of the trade, and I'm going to focus on small arms, on guns, firearms. And then at the end, I'll reflect for an instant on that distinction between trafficking and trade with reference to the future. So when firearms became central to warfare, governments faced a structural problem. They needed gun manufacturers, but only intermittently. Now, allowing gun makers to smooth that uneven government demand by selling their arms to civilians was often too dangerous. In early modern England, for instance, which is what I've worked on, it was a time of dynastic and religious conflict, and firearms in civilian hands seemed to spell a risk of civil war. So to support gun makers in peacetime so that they would still be around in wartime, the British government encouraged gun makers to sell their guns abroad. So guns wound up enabling the kind of astonishing expansion of the British Empire in the 18th century as commodities, as a currency, and as powerful symbols and actual weapons for opening up markets and seizing land. Including in North America. And arms sales also oiled the slave trade. They were sold to Native Americans and settlers in North America. They were gifted to Native Americans and to South Asian polities as part of the diplomacy of conquest. And these sales and gifts were considered essential to British prestige and influences and influence in those regions, and essential to smothering indigenous arms making, because that would also be a kind of threat we can talk about later. Now, the East India Company was the main agent of British expansion in the Indian subcontinent, and it was itself a mass purchaser of firearms. And I think Brian mentioned that many of the guns that wound up in Mexico were East India pattern round besses, right? They were the most massively produced arms of the period. And all these sales, in the interest of empire, help drive industrialization in Britain. Now, at times, British officials, predictably, expressed concern that they might be arming their own enemies abroad. But such concerns were inevitably appeased with the argument that if they didn't do so, they would be forfeiting profit and prestige and influence because those buyers would simply turn to the French or some other rival instead. Or worse, those buyers would just make their own arms, and that would be the worst. Moreover, at least this way, the British knew what kind of arms their opponents had. Now, powerful anti-colonial movements began to emerge by the middle and late 19th century all around the world, and the appeal of that logic started to wane. And by the late 19th century, British officials are sort of belatedly struggling to limit arms possession among the Irish, Indians, Afghans, the Maori, Black South Africans, and all kinds of other people that it ruled. Now, the efforts of such groups to obtain arms in defiance of those British restrictions gave rise to that moralizing language of arms trafficking. It was about a colonial concern with the wrong people getting arms, not about arms themselves being a bad good, in the way that we say drug trafficking or human trafficking, when the idea is the moral objection is to the thing itself. Now, Despite these restrictions on colonial rebels buying guns, European arms sales continued to thrive. In fact, European and American arms companies often partnered with banks by the late 19th century, and those banks would give loans to client states. And then lots of people start criticizing the ensuing arms race as leading up to World War I. And in response, these arms companies would remind these concerned critics that their factories, their arms factories, were essential to industry generally, that their profits accrued to vast bodies of shareholders and employees. And in fact, a 1935 British Royal Commission affirmed the reality of very wide public investment in the arms industry, despite the growing criticism of arms makers as uniquely villainous merchants of death. Now, the modern world we have inherited was shaped by this history of arms sales, and it continues to be. Like the British in the 18th century, the US government today eases arms sales abroad and at home as part of what we now call the military-industrial complex. Though a long global effort to regulate global firearms sales has culminated in the Arms Trade Treaty of 2014, instead of ratifying it, the Trump administration is trying to ease controls on firearm exports by moving their oversight from the State Department to the Commerce Department, where some sales may not even require licensing, and some of the effects of that Brian already talked about in Mexico. So, in fact, American arms are on all sides of the conflict in Afghanistan and Syria. The Islamic State has American arms. I'm sure you're all familiar with this. And complicity in these sales, as in 18th century Britain, remains wide. Ordinary people like us participate through our tax support, and we benefit through investment, employment, and so on. Even the art world thrives off of donations from gun makers like the Beretta family. The firearms industry is, of course, part of a wider arms industry whose global sales are similarly brokered by governments in the name of jobs and security, including, for instance, the controversial Trump administration arms sales to Saudi Arabia, despite their role in devastating Yemen and the Saudi government's abuses of its own citizens. And a revolving door between defense agencies and arms firms facilitates this military-industrial complex. Even Silicon Valley, of course, owes its rise to defense contracts, which remain important today. Meanwhile, strict gun laws in other countries have made American civilians the single most important market in the world for firearms manufacturers. America has always had gun control, historically, but the NRA, of course, peddles a myth that America is built on the idea of unregulated gun ownership, and it does this in order to protect access to this civilian market. So as a result, American civilians now own nearly half the firearms that exist in the world. The American government and governments around the world have an interest in keeping this civilian market open to support an industry understood as essential to security. Now, those concerned about this trafficking and its violent results tend to focus on the villainy of the NRA and the politicians in its pocket. But as I said earlier, complicity is much wider. And that collective investment in a way of life built on arms sales is sustained by the idea that security depends on a mutually terrorized public and a mutually terrorized globe. And this idea has sustained ties between war and industrial capitalism since the 18th century. But the same period, this whole modern period, has also given us alternative visions of social organization that question whether industrial capitalism, with all its human and environmental wreckage, is really a kind of inescapable default. Arms makers themselves also sometimes suffer from bad conscience, most famously perhaps for those of us who live locally, Sarah Winchester was haunted by the ghosts of those killed by the Winchester rifle. And bad conscience drove her into building this crazy mansion in the heart of what is now Silicon Valley, the Winchester Mystery House. Have all of you been there? You guys know what I'm talking about. No? Go to San Jose and see the Winchester Mystery House this weekend. But she went on with arms manufacturing, partly just to pay for the construction of this unending project. So, do we all have to be like, we don't want to be like Sarah Winchester, she's not a model, but is it possible to reckon more practically with this military-industrial system in which we are all collectively complicit? Now, the gun control movement is pressuring companies to disengage from the firearms industry, and it's true that sustained activism can produce cultural change in the same manner that the NRA's activism has produced a cultural change. And as Brian has brilliantly argued in another work that he didn't talk about today, that you should look up, our taxpaying power can be leveraged in decisions about local, state, and federal arms contracts. And then there is the manufacturing capacity of arms makers themselves. 18th century gun makers coped with uneven government demand by selling guns abroad, right? But they also coped with uneven demand by diversifying their products. They made things like buckles and harpoons and swords and so on. And then 19th century gun makers made bicycles and typewriters and razor blades and so on. Now, today's arms makers might also turn swords into plowshares. And as we face environmental devastation, plowshares are actually probably more crucial to security than arms. They might, in short, contract for welfare rather than warfare. In 1807, the British government abolished the slave trade, despite many vested interests in it, out of a sense that humans were not a morally defensible commodity. Some goods should simply not be sold. And this is why the word trafficking, I think, creates a false distinction when it comes to arms, in distinguishing between sort of legal and illegal arms trades. It's not the legality that matters, but whether the commodity in question is morally defensible given the political, moral, economic, and existential stakes. Thank you so much.
Thank you, that was great. And so I'm here to represent political science. Weapons are a primary concern for international relations scholars, of whom I'm one. I think in part because IR scholars view power first and foremost in terms of military force. There's a significant corpus on the production and the sale of weapons of mass destruction, or large weapons platforms, submarines, aircraft carriers, missile systems, jets, helicopters, etc. But there is no literature, let alone theory, regarding arms trafficking. The few articles that are in circulation are very weakly cited and appear in journals of international law and crime, not journals of international security or international politics. In other words, political scientists don't think that this is a political science problem. They think of it as an organized crime problem related to narcotics or corruption. The literature has not linked the small arms issue with terrorism, for example, in a theoretically or empirically robust way, which I think is a shame. Since there is no political science literature on weapons trafficking for me to lean on, the best I can offer is to speculate about how my colleagues would write about this issue if they did take it on. The answer, in brief, is that they would assume a rationalist and a materialist stance. My functionalist colleagues would focus on strategic military threats and ask how these weapon traffickings address those challenges. My factionalist colleagues would focus on procurement policy and shift the lens away from overarching military needs and onto domestic political conflicts. Geostrategists would emphasize global conflicts and shifts in world order as an external driving force pushing actors to acquire arms. So if you think about the case of Israel, for example, which is a case I'm relatively familiar with, if you look at it through one lens, which is the lens that I hear called functionalist, you would think of the young state of Israel seeking among its allies the weapons that it needs to defend itself first in 48. The suppliers are Czech, of all places, with the blessing of the Soviet Union. Later on, France is a primary source of munitions. And only very late in the process, after Israel has almost survived most of its existential conflicts, does the United States step in. And now that the United States has stepped out again, it's an interesting question to ask from that point of view, who would Israel turn to next, given the fact that the United States and Israel are cooperating in weapons manufacture, and that the other competitors in the Middle East, Russia and China, have little to offer on that front. So that would be the sort of functionalist approach. The functionalist approach, I think, would also emphasize how the United States is tying Israel to the US economy by offering a very substantial amount of foreign aid. Sometimes Israel is the number one recipient, at times it's been the number two recipient of foreign military aid from the United States that can only be used to buy in the United States American weapons. It is not to be used by Israel for any other purpose. That's true for Egypt, that's true for Jordan, that's true for Afghanistan, which for a while was the number one recipient. So that's the functionalist approach. The factionalists look at domestic drivers of munitions purchase, and they would be very interested to see how leaders in Israel or in any other country decide between foreign purchase, which create a dependency, and domestic production, which encourage development, encourage local investment, but have weaknesses of their own. In the case of Israel, this was an investment in Elbit, in Rafael, and in Israeli military industry that rose and fell depending on the extent to which France, the United States, and Britain were willing to help or not. So when you get help from allies, it suppresses your domestic production. When allies fall by the wayside, like the French who in 67 just abandoned the Israeli alliance, you become more independent. And then the geostrategic lens would discuss armament levels in the Middle East, I think primarily by looking at Cold War effects. The Arab-Israeli conflict would not have lasted half as long as it did and would not have led to half the number of fatalities had it not been a game played by the United States and the Soviet Union, both to sell weapons, to try out weapons, and to try out tactics and strategies that were attached to those weapons. There are two modest exceptions to this relative disinterest among my colleagues, and those are scholarly progress on the institutional front, which we've alluded to briefly in the last hour, and some exciting work on norms in arms trafficking, which I think I am more excited about than anyone else in the world, but I'll share it with you and you tell me what you think. In the first group are scholars who study the growing efforts to prevent and combat illicit trafficking. They note that regional organizations like the European Union, the Organization of American States, Mercosur, the Organization of African Unity, et cetera, have all stepped up their efforts on that front. These scholars place particular hope in United Nations work to organize conferences and develop protocols against arms manufacturing and trafficking, and several of those exist, and they work to some extent. States are increasingly coordinating on regulating legal arms transfer, coordinating arms brokering, marking and tracing firearms, managing weapon stockpiles and destruction of those stockpiles, and collecting arms from civilians. An even smaller group of scholars is interested in how these regional and international agreements are fostering shared global norms around, and I quote, the excessive and destabilizing accumulation and transfer of small arms and light weapons, in particular as they cause and exacerbate conflict. These norms include passing more stringent national legislation, implementing better arms transfer licensing systems, enhancing border controls, and customs authorities, and improving international information exchange. In my mind, the most fascinating literature on this topic, which is very small, is less interested in international norms against trafficking and more interested in the normative foundation of the trafficked weapons themselves, which is sort of a nice transition, I think, from what you had to say. Most scholars study trafficking from a rationalist perspective. The scholars I am now discussing are interested in weapons as symbols, primarily symbols of modernization and sovereignty. They view their production and purchase as signals that states send one another to demonstrate reputation. Let me conclude with a quote from one of my favorite studies by Mark Suchman and Dane Eyre, both trained in sociology at Stanford, which they then foolishly left. Here's the quote. It is all too easy to fall into the trap of assuming that the reason human beings arm is to fight, and the reason they fight is to win. If instead we take weapons seriously, not only as tools of destruction, but also as sacred symbols, that's when they got my attention, sacred symbols, we may gain a better understanding of the role of war in our worldview and of the role of the warrior in our cultural ethos. Ultimately, we may find that to prevent the irrationality of armed conflicts, we must first understand the non-rational meanings that we have constructed for our acts of arming and for our armaments themselves. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, I would like to begin just by acknowledging my debt to Brian. Brian has been my closest collaborator at Berkeley, so it's a real honor to be able to participate in an event like this in which he is the headline act. I should also acknowledge that Brian was really the first person to alert me to the fact that the arms trade had a history and that this history could have significant implications for other histories in which I, as a diplomatic historian, a historian of American foreign relations, might be interested. So in a sense, although what I am going to say tonight is not a direct response to Brian's presentation, it very much bears the imprint of Brian's influence over recent years. I should say, though, one caveat. The views expressed here are entirely my own. With much of what I am going to say, I think Brian will probably vigorously disagree. So I'm going to focus this evening on the relationship between arms and American hegemony. Arms as a constituent element of what we might call the American world order, or Pax Americana. And I want to start from the presumption that the intimate place of arms in the making of an American-centered world order, Pax Americana, is profoundly ironic. After all, Woodrow Wilson, the president whom diplomatic historians commonly identify as the founding father of American internationalism, once issued 14 famous points. The fourth was this. It assured that the international community to emerge from the First World War should take, and here I quote directly, adequate guarantees given and taken that national armaments will be reduced to the lowest point consistent with domestic safety. At the moment of genesis, American conceptions of international order are profoundly antagonistic to this phenomenon, the international arms trade, that will become, over the long arc of the 20th century, utterly constituent of a US-centered hierarchical international order, the Pax Americana. So the interesting question for me as a historian is, how does this happen? Not immediately. In the 1920s, after the Senate's rejection of Woodrow Wilson's League of Nations Treaty, the United States participates in a series of international efforts to control and corral the international arms trade. The United States hosts in 1921, 1922, a set of naval conferences intended to reduce naval armaments. The United States participates in a series of ill-fated disarmament conferences that take place in Geneva and ultimately culminate in an unsuccessful Geneva disarmament conference in 1933. Throughout this phase, a movement of historical revisionism, concerned with the nefarious relationship between arms and finance in the genesis and waging of the First World War, animates Americans, public intellectuals, policymakers, ordinary citizens, to take a strong and robust stand against the arms trade. Books are published, best-selling books with titles like Merchants of Death, War is a Racket, and these give you some sense of the animus with which Americans in the 1920s and 1930s view the international trade in weapons of war. In 1935, the Nye Committee in Congress convenes a series of hearings to examine the relationship between the arms trade, international finance, and US participation in the First World War. And that committee's conclusion is that there had been a nefarious linkage. The arms industry the committee held was squarely responsible for dragging the United States into the First World War. And the mood of outrage that the committee's hearings fuel sort of propels a turn away from the international arms trade in US domestic politics in the 1930s. This mood manifests perhaps most consequentially in the series of neutrality laws that the Congress passes beginning in 1935 that seek to circumscribe future US participation in the international trade in weapons. Now, we should acknowledge that the prohibitionary turn in US attitudes towards the arms trade is not always and invariably beneficial. When a civil war breaks out in Spain in August 1936, the US Congress quickly slaps down an embargo on US arms exports to the Spanish Republic. This embargo has the direct consequence of facilitating the Franco-nationalist insurgency's overthrow of the Spanish Republic. Denied the weapons of war with which it might have defended itself more adeptly against Franco's armies, armies that were supported with weapons by Germany and Italy, both fascist powers, the Spanish Republic falls to defeat. And the US, in a sense, by imposing an arms embargo, becomes complicit in the overthrow of a liberal democratic republic at the hands of a fascist insurgency. In the late 1930s, though, the Nazi consolidation of power in Europe pushes the United States to re-examine, reconsider its relationship to the international arms trade. From 1939, Franklin Roosevelt strives to prepare the United States for possible embroilment in the Second World War and to provide whatever assistance he might be able to provide to Great Britain. Yet domestic isolationism, a potent political force, thwarts Roosevelt's efforts to ready the United States for war and to aid Great Britain. Running for re-election in 1940, FDR feels called to promise an audience in Boston, Massachusetts, "Your boys will not be sent into any foreign wars." The mood of political isolationism in the United States is so strong that Roosevelt has to sort of abandon the very possibility that the United States might directly involve itself in Europe's wars. Instead, FDR concocts an alternative strategy for aiding Great Britain and countering the Axis powers. And this is to set the United States up as an arms dealer to the democratic world. This strategy is encapsulated famously in the Arsenal of Democracy speech that Roosevelt delivers at the end of 1940. Cognizant that the American people is not going to tolerate direct US involvement in the Second World War, Roosevelt instead proposes to make the United States the arsenal of democracy, to furnish the fruits of American industry to benefit the British, and after the German invasion of the Soviet Union, the USSR too, to sort of buttress and support these powers in their war against Nazi Germany. Of course, Pearl Harbor in December 1941 transforms the strategic landscape and makes it possible for the United States to involve itself directly in the Second World War to counter sort of the military and geopolitical threat of Nazi Germany. After the Second World War, arms will become an integral modality of American Cold War hegemony. The United States quickly sets itself up in an intensifying, escalating Cold War as a guarantor of security to subordinate allies. American security guarantees will be encapsulated, perhaps most famously, in Article 5 of the North Atlantic Treaty of 1949, a clause that commits the United States to the security of its West European allies. Yet the United States also strives to uphold the security of its allies through the direct provision of weapons of war, through the military assistance program that Congress enacts in 1950s. The US throws open the doors of the armory and invites Europeans to take what they need. The only prohibition will be on American transfers of nuclear arms to Western Europe. But even here, the United States shows some flexibility. The United States will not sell nuclear weapons to its West European allies, but it does concoct in the 1950s a variety of schemes for giving West Europeans effective sort of de facto control over US nuclear weapons. Arms, in the context of an escalating Cold War, become constitutive of international order. As the Cold War escalates, the United States assumes on behalf of its allies responsibility for security. This is a point worth pondering. Security, historically, in the Westphalian era, has been a defining attribute of sovereignty. What makes the state a state is its capacity to protect its citizens against untimely, violent death. In the context of an escalating Cold War, the United States will come to exercise this determinative sort of attribute of sovereignty on behalf of its subordinate Cold War allies. The model which is deployed in Europe, the model that I have just described, will be deployed elsewhere in a Cold War world. The United States formulates relationships of military cooperation in Latin America, relationships that our colleague Becca Herman has adeptly described in her work on US military basing in Latin America. The United States concocts a raft of bilateral security agreements in East Asia. It builds regional security frameworks in Southeast Asia and elsewhere, including in the Middle East. As the Cold War progresses, the retreat of European imperialism from the decolonizing and increasingly post-colonial world pushes the United States to expand its role as a provider of arms. Arms become increasingly a vital guarantee of regional security and of US hegemonic power. An illustrative case in point will follow the British retreat from military positions east of Suez in 1967. After the British decide that they can no longer sort of take responsibility for providing military security in the Persian Gulf, American officials ponder the question of how regional military security in the Persian Gulf region is to be assured. The Nixon administration concocts an ad hoc solution whereby the United States will provide weapons of war to Iran and Saudi Arabia, which become the twin pillars of American regional security strategy in the Persian Gulf. To this end, the United States once again throws open the doors of the armory. In a remarkable 1972 meeting with the Shah of Iran, the United States tells Iran that it is willing to purchase any weapons that the United States has to sell. Even more striking, Richard Nixon, President of the United States, tells the Shah of Iran that he is willing for Iran to ratchet up oil prices in order for Iran to be able to pay for the weapons that it's going to be importing from the United States. Iran in the 1970s becomes the world's single largest importer of weapons. It builds up a remarkable arsenal, an arsenal that will even include the world's largest fleet of military hovercraft, a quite remarkable sort of expression of Iran's military capability. Of course, we know how this story ends. We could invoke the case of Iran in the 1970s as a parable, cautioning against the pernicious and destabilizing effects of the international trade in arms. Indeed, there is a powerful case to be made that the Shah's preoccupation with building up Iran's military power contributed to the destabilization and, in 1979, overthrow of his regime. However, I am not so sure that we should rush to that cautionary conclusion. Let me just make 3 points by way of conclusion. First, we should always be mindful that the decision for a great power, a superpower like the United States, to withhold participation in the international arms trade is an ethical choice. For sure, deciding to provide arms to weaker powers in the international system is an ethical choice, but so too is the decision to withdraw and withhold oneself from participation in the international arms trade. I've already described the example of Spain in the 1930s. We might also think about the case of Bosnia in the 1990s. The arms embargo that the international community slapped on Bosnia in the context of the Bosnian Civil War made it very difficult for the Bosnian government to protect itself, to protect its civilians against vicious and violent attacks staged by internal insurgents with weapons of war provided by rogue powers, the Republic of Serbia most consequentially. We could think about the case of Syria since 2011, and that's probably more to say on that point too. My second point, second concluding point, states that lack arms industries depend upon the international arms trade in the 21st century in order to be able to exercise what Max Weber defined as a sort of defining attribute of sovereignty, which is the capacity to exercise legitimate violence. Brian showed very, very eloquently in his talk what happens in circumstance like Mexico today, in which states lack sort of effective monopolies over the exercise of violence. Chaos and mayhem can easily ensue. As the world's largest exporter of armaments, the United States is uniquely, well, not uniquely, but perhaps singularly capable of providing other states in the international system with the means of destruction necessary to exercise legitimate monopolies over sort of the use of violent force. This is a remarkable power, and the United States should be very wary of using this power frivolously without sort of due care and consideration. But it is also important to remember that the arms trade constitutes a lever of power that can enable the United States to exercise to influence in more positive ways the internal conditions of countries that receive arms from the United States. The tethering, for example, of specific human rights conditions to arms deliveries can function as a means to ameliorate a sort of human rights depredations in countries that receive weapons of war from the United States. in Latin America, for example, during the 1970s. The tethering of human rights conditions to military assistance may have served to nudge the trajectory for human rights in Argentina, just to describe one case, in the right direction. We should also consider on this point a scenario in which the United States unilaterally restrains its role as a deliverer of weapons to sort of developing societies. Would the world be safer? Would developing states be more secure if the United States ceded this vital lever of power and influence to Russia and China? It is a point that I think is worth mulling. Finally, let me make my third point, which is that the alternative to US arms trading may be worse. Here, the Iranian case is, I believe, also instructive. Let us think briefly about what happens in Iran subsequent to the revolution of 1979. In the aftermath of the Iranian Revolution, the Carter administration contemplates the question of how regional military security in the Persian Gulf region is to be provided. Bereft of alternatives, the Iranians can no longer be relied upon to police the Gulf. The Carter administration decides that the United States should adopt and exercise direct responsibility for assuring military security in the Persian Gulf region. The United States creates a regional military security architecture, which evolves in 1983 into United States Central Command, the first of the unified combatant command architectures that today envelop the planet. In the absence of subsidiary sort of relationships whereby the United States equips regional allies with responsibility for sort of exercising regional military security, the United States may feel called upon to exercise such military functions on its own. And I think we should beware of the escalating sort of cascading responsibilities that can ensue from this sort of alternative scenario for security provision. But let me say, before I sign off, that we should always be aware of the costs that the arms control can sort of embroil us in. The United States, over the long arc of the 20th century, created an hierarchical international order in which weapons, arms, became a defining modality of international power. Today, such relationships may have metastasized into a political and constitutional crisis that threatens the very fate of the republic itself. After all, the United States Congress in 2014 began to appropriate funds to support Ukraine in its struggle against Russia. Russia, of course, since 2014 has invaded Crimea, taken the Crimean Peninsula from Russia. It's also supported insurgents in eastern Ukraine, in the Donbass region. The United States has strived to support the government of Ukraine in its efforts to maintain regional security within its sovereign borders. Yet the relationships of dependency that the arms trade has sort of helped to build between the United States and Ukraine tempted the incumbent president, Donald Trump, to seek to use arms trading as a lever from which to extract specific political favors from the government of Ukraine. And the consequences, of course, have today propelled the United States to the cusp of the severest constitutional crisis since Watergate. In conclusion, the relationships of inequality that the international arms trade creates and that have been integral to the American world order since 1945, embroil states, including the United States, in relationships of hierarchy, but also of mutual vulnerability that can redound to the detriment not only of the powerless, but also, as we see today in Washington, of the most powerful. Thank you.
Well, I wondered if we would find our way to Ukraine and the $400 million, and we got there. But there are many places to go, and we have some time. So if there are questions, comments from the audience, our panel is ready to respond. Any thoughts? George Breslauer.
George Breslauer, political science. Brian, I wanted to ask you whether, as you were talking, I was wondering whether supply is the driver or demand is the driver, or does supply create the demand?
Wow, that's a hard question.
I think it is on. Yeah, can you? Okay. Well, now I think the answer to that question would vary case to case, story to story. In the story that I told today, mainly a 19th century story, demand was, I think, more internal to Mexico. And it was, in fact, partly produced by the very weakness of the state. I mean, the weakness of the state meant that one need not acquire that much firepower to actively challenge it or to even contemplate trying to capture it. And so that ends up hatching innumerable schemes that if we can only get our hands on 10,000 rifles, 20,000 rifles, we could transform this country. So I think in the story I told that it is primarily about internal demand, but it's also the case that Mexico's history would have been fundamentally different if it didn't share a land border with one of the world's great arms producers. And so supply is clearly a huge part of the story. You know, if the polity that was north of Mexico was like every other polity in the Western Hemisphere and had failed to create its own arms industry, then I think the history of Mexico would have looked very, very different. So they're both really important. It's a great question.
Carol Clover. Oh, I thought you had your hand. Excuse me. Go ahead.
So I'd like to ask a question about Mexico. Of course, the United States has had a bad effect on Mexico, but it sort of worked the other way around. In World War I, you had the Zimmerman telegram. You brought us all the way up to World War I, and I'm surprised you didn't bring up the Zimmerman telegram. This was a telegram from Germany to Mexico promising an alliance with Mexico if Mexico would attack the United States. Mm-hmm. What in God's name were they thinking?
Well, I don't know. I don't have a good answer to that question. I can tell you that it was a sort of preposterous idea on its face, and I think it was about basically trying to create as much diversion and chaos in the Western Hemisphere as possible in anticipation of the United States becoming a major problem for Germany's ambitions in Europe. You know, and in its most romantic guise, it's a question of reclaiming all of this territory that the United States took from Mexico in the previous 50 years. But that was a completely forlorn, insane proposition that I think no one in power in Mexico could have taken very seriously.
Yes. I have a question for Daniel Sargent. So you mentioned that the Congress decided that the arms industry, in fact, was one of the driving forces for the U.S. entry into World War I. What, in fact, now, with 2020 hindsight, we can look back and see how important was, in fact, the arms industry in leading us into World War I?
No, that's a great question. Others may have thoughts on this too. I would say it's very, very significant. The British opt from early in the war, and Priya probably has more perspective on this than I do, but to deploy a warfighting strategy that seeks to mobilize American manufacturing industry as a vital adjunct to the British war effort. And this, of course, necessitates the extensive transatlantic shipment of American weapons of war, which exposes sort of American merchant shipping to attack by German submarines. The almost inevitably sort of resulting clashes that ensue have a significant sort of deleterious effect on U.S.-German relations and serve to propel the United States to the cusp of war.
Anybody else want to respond to this question? Sure. I mean, there's a similar critique after the First World War in Britain, where people say, well, this was all caused by this arms race and the corruption, the corrupt relationships between arms makers and the press and the government, right? And it leads eventually to this Royal Commission, which is actually partly inspired by the Nye Committee in the United States to really investigate, is that why the war happened? And for the most part, the Royal Commission gives private arms manufacturers a pass. They do feel that ideally it should not be done privately, but in fact, the situation they've inherited is one in which so many people are, in one way or another, invested in the continuation of that way of providing arms to the state that it should really just go on. I mean, a few tweaks were suggested, but then the report gets buried because rearmament starts after the rise of Hitler is happening in the kind of background to this. But whether, I mean, so they're investigating it after the fact. I think we can look back and see that there definitely is a kind of arms race going on. And a lot of the tensions between the great powers around the turn of the 20th century are related to concerns about, the French are getting guns into Somaliland, the British are concerned about that, and relations with the Ottoman Empire, which are being governed by arms sales and competition between the Germans and the British and so on. So that is there. But in a way, it's just one of the ways in which all these great powers are in this kind of rivalrous dynamic that eventually kind of has to be sorted out militarily, right? And part of it is the story of the rise of nationalism, the problems of the Balkan regions, and there are so many other reasons. But the fact that there are these guns, I mean, the arms race sort of is part of that rivalrous kind of dynamic that leads to the war, and certainly made it possible for war to start and play out because all the armaments were there. So yeah, I hope that helps.
I just add really quickly that I think that this interwar period is one of the most fascinating and ultimately depressing things we can contemplate when we're thinking about the question of what civil society can do with the problem of the arms trade, because the level of international concern over the arms trade was just orders of magnitude more intense and committed then than it is now. And that period of intense civic organization culminated in the greatest war in human history. That's where it ended up. So the and part of the problem is precisely that when civil unhappiness with the arms industry pushed governments to change policy, as it did in Great Britain. In Great Britain, what happens is that the state pulls back from its traditional role of financing major arms shipments as a way of facilitating the expansion of its own business, precisely because of public outrage. And so what happens? France partly steps into the breach, and the Czechs totally step into the breach. So the Czechs really just eat Britain's lunch. And so you really do need global decision-making on this point.
But there's a weird positive outcome within Britain of this, because what happens is because the British government starts buying guns from continental manufacturers rather than from British gun makers, starting with the Czechs in the interwar period, eventually they are free from dependence on British gun manufacturers, and those manufacturers have less and less clout. So there's no British gun lobby by the time mass shootings are happening in Britain in the 80s and 90s. Mm. And that's why today there's virtually no guns in England, and there are no mass shootings. So within the UK, that turned out to be a good story. The fact that the domestic gun industry was wiped out by the increasing reliance on foreign suppliers. Mm-hmm. It's not all depressing.
Yeah. I can't answer the historical question because I'm not a historian. And that is also why I like my colleague George Breslar's question best, because we political scientists like hang out together and ask this sort of broader systemic questions. So all I'd like to say is I think George has put his finger on a thread that ran through our three presentations and Brian's very excellent presentation, and that is the tension between supply as a cause and demand as a cause, the push versus the pull. If I understood Brian and Priya's presentations, the emphasis there was on the supply. If I understood Daniel's presentation, there was a leaning more on demand. What I tried to propose are four different lenses. Now that I think about it, two of them emphasize supply, two of them emphasize demand. And it seems to me that it would be foolhardy to look at these questions without at least combining both points of view. So I think it is interesting to know who's enabling conflict by supplying weapons. I think it's no less interesting to ask who's making the production of weapons interesting and attractive for weapons manufacturers by requiring them, demanding them, and using them. And that's true not just at the domestic level and not just at the regional level when it comes to rivalries and how they ratchet up, but it's also true on the global level. And global constellations of power that are, in my mind at least, a lot more significant than the interest of a gun manufacturer there or an airplane designer here.
before the faculty club's formidable wine cellar demands our attention, one more question.
You discussed sort of hard metal bullets and guns kind of weapons, but you haven't discussed trafficking in more insidious kinds of weapons, chemical and biological, and the threat from those. And you know, you mentioned World War I, going back to phosgene, and World War II, Zyklon gas, and now sarin. And how are we addressing issues of stemming the spread of trafficking in those kinds of really scary kinds of weapons?
Well, I gave a lecture on this to my undergraduate class earlier this week, so I'm...
Remember, wine awaits us.
Well, the question is, the answer is pretty straightforward. We're not. There are three options, and they don't work particularly well. We've alluded to all three in our different talks. Option number one is deterring your opponent. This is difficult for reasons I'm happy to go into over wine. The second D is denying your opponent the capacity to hurt you, which is complicated for other reasons, mostly because our opponents, like ourselves, are very smart about designing weapons that cannot be denied. And the third D is disarmament, and that's failed pretty miserably on the weapons of mass destruction front. Perhaps some brownie points go to the Non-Proliferation Treaty, which has managed to keep the number of nuclear countries under lid, but has not been exceedingly successful with chemical and biological weapons. In that sense, international treaties to curb small arms trafficking have been far more successful. All that said, fatalities from small arms vastly overshadow. They don't quite have, perhaps, the same captivating impression on the media, on the government, especially because we associate weapons of mass destruction with terrorism, again, for no apparent reason. Certainly no good empirical reason to link those two. But yes, we have not done well. That lecture is quite a depressing lecture.
By way of adjournment, Priya, I ask you to join me in thanking our four speakers.
Thank you again. Thank you, David, for helping to organize this. And let me invite you to join the reception. So with this, I hereby dissolve the 2087th meeting of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences.